Welcome back to Wood for the Trees, our series of films about the future of British woodlands and forests. My name is Tom Barnes. I work in the British timber industry, but I'm also an environmentalist. For this film, we're going to focus on the quality of trees. We hear lots about planting of trees in terms of numbers and areas and sometimes a little bit about species. But we don't hear much about the quality of the trees and their provenance. In other words, where do they come from? You might ask, why is it important to get timber from trees? Why not leave the trees in the ground to absorb CO2 and do all the good things that trees do? Well, I would argue it is important because simply absorbing CO2 is not going to get us out of the hole we're in. We need to dramatically reduce CO2 emissions, and we need to do it fast. And a big chunk of these emissions come from making building products like concrete and steel and plastic. The good news is that these carbon intensive products can be replaced in many situations by wood and other bio-based materials. If we can accept that using more wood is part of the solution, where's it all going to come from? We're already the second biggest importer of timber globally behind China. And that's before we fully embrace the use of bio-based materials in building. Unfortunately, despite political pledges, there has been very little tree planting in this country, particularly in England over the last few decades. And almost none of the wood planted is going to yield any timber in the future. I have a special interest in this subject. I've grown up in a family sawmilling business that turns locally grown trees into timber products. So I know what a good timber tree looks like. It wants to be quite tall, straight, and relatively free of knots. But what I don't know so much about is why one tree grows like that, but another one doesn't. To find out more about this, our producer Charlie met up with Dr. Joe Clark of the FutureTreesTrust, an organisation dedicated to breeding improved hardwood trees to support the British timber trade, to find out what they've been up to for the last few decades.
My name's Joe Clark. I'm head of research at FutureTreesTrust. I've been working in hardwood tree improvement for nearly 20 years now. The main aim of the FutureTreesTrust is to work with commercially important timber species for broadleaves. And these are like oak, ash, sycamore, chestnut, cherry, and birch. So the aim of a breeding program is so that we can produce trees for planting that are of higher quality than normal planting stock. And this means that it's quicker for these trees to get established, maybe saving a year in establishment costs. It means our trees can grow a little bit faster. It means that the rotation can be reduced a little bit. These trees, with their longer and straighter lengths of timber, will be used in bigger building projects rather than planting lower quality stock, which often ends up as firewood. The very start of the breeding program is our base population, which we call our plus trees. These are outstanding examples of a tree of its species. So let's talk sycamore since we're at Bathurst Estate. So sycamore is a little bit controversial because it's not actually a native species. It's what we term naturalised. It arrived around 1600, but it's naturalised by its own efforts right across Britain. And in fact, if you look at the genetics of sycamore, you can see that it forms one big population, whereas species like ash and oak that got here after the last ice age, they actually form more various populations, and there are actually genetic differences between regions of the country. But sycamore form one big breeding population. So we have plus trees in here that come from all over the UK. So I will walk into a stand and we'll cruise that stand and we'll look at all the trees to find the one that looks the best. It will be the tallest, it'll be the straightest, it'll have a nice round cylindrical stem, it'll have a really good crown and no forking. And this is the tree's phenotype, what it looks like. But what we don't know is what the tree's genotype is. What is it that makes it grow like that? Is it just that it's growing there in that very nice piece of ground? Or if we took that tree and planted it elsewhere, would it still grow just as well, i.e. it's got really good genetics? Or in fact, is there something going on which we call the genotype environment interaction, where the genetics of the tree are interacting with the environment where it's growing to give it that good phenotype? So to be able to evaluate the genetics, we have to carry out what we call progeny testing. So we have our parent tree, our plus tree, and we collect the seed from that tree. Now we know the mother tree because the seed came from that tree, but what we don't know is the pollen donor, the father. So this forms what we call a half-sib family. They're half-siblings from the same mother, different fathers. And we collect seed from many of these plus trees. We raise them in nurseries and then they get planted out in a replicated progeny trial. So this is the offspring, the progeny, from one parent tree. And behind would be the offspring from another parent tree. And they're replicated in multiple plots across this site and across other sites so that we can test how the genetics from our mother tree perform in multiple environments. And we will come back many times and measure the height, the diameter, but almost more importantly is the form. The sawmillers like timber in 3 meter lengths that go through the mill very easily. So we want tall, straight trees that can be milled easily. So very important is the apical dominance. This is how the leader goes straight through the tree. And if we look at this tree, you can see it's a straight stem going all the way through. There is no forking. So that's good. So this has got good apical dominance. Forking is less desirable because then obviously the tree is putting resources into two forks, less into the single girth that we want. We also assess the timing of bud burst. This is the tree's phenology. And this is also very important because trees that flush, that come into leaf very early, could get frost damage, and this can result in poor form. We also assess different things on the form of the tree. So we like light horizontal branching that we can see. This is such a small minor fork that this, by the time the tree grows a bit more, this will not be an issue. So when people are planting trees, I think it's really important that they consider what they're planting and where it's come from. It's not just a matter of buying trees and popping them in the ground. It's really important to ask your supplier what region of provenance you're getting your material from. Thinking to the future, we know the climate is warming. So we have to ask ourselves, how are the trees we're planting today going to cope with those warming environment? So for me, it makes very logical sense to bring in some material from the near continent that is from a maritime climate, so northern France, that is partially adapted already to those likely climates of the future. You could still use some local provenance material, some local seed zone material, but where you're trying to grow trees for the future for timber, think about what you're planting and where it's coming from. In other European countries where they're planting trees for timber and there is improved material available, they have to plant that by law. And I think my one policy suggestion would be that this should be the same in the UK, and that where we have qualified or tested material available, there should be a requirement to use it. And there is qualified material available already for sycamore, for birch, for cherry. And oak is coming and chestnut is coming. We have these orchards planted. It's just a few more years to wait until they start producing seed.
Thank you, Jo. That was a fascinating insight into the process of breeding good quality trees. The general message I take away from this film is that if we are going to plant 30,000 hectares a year, which is the government's pledge, it's really important that we plant quality. And it seems sensible to plant trees that are going to yield the low carbon building products of the future. As Jo told us, quality also means that trees establish themselves more quickly, that they grow faster, and that they need less pruning, which is good news all round, especially for the landowners. And Jo also mentioned that poor quality trees will end up in firewood or in biomass, but good quality trees are valuable and they are more likely to end up in a long-term end use such as construction, which means that the carbon that's been absorbed by the tree is locked up for many, many decades. To be clear, I don't believe that every woodland should have to produce timber. During this series of films, we found out about all of the amazing benefits that trees can offer, from increasing biodiversity, as use in agroforestry, for our own mental health and well-being, and for the protection of water and soil. But I do agree with Jo that we need a national effort to grow trees for timber. Growing timber requires good quality trees, and these start life as good quality seeds. As ever, thank you for watching our film. Please do leave comments and do sign up to our channel to catch future films. Goodbye.